In 1929, we were looking up into the sky at shapes like this. Airships. And a lot of people thought they had a big future. After their lighter-than-air jobs of the war, the Germans continued to develop airships in the peace. The Graf Zeppelin always seemed to be coming or going. There was a lot in favor of airships, so the people who believed in them said. For example, there was space in them. The crew could even climb out and tackle an engine in flight. All modern conveniences, hot and cold water, and all the gas they could possibly need. Only I suppose it was more than your life was worth to strike a match. The Germans weren't the only ones with these big ideas. Britain built the R-100 and R-101, both operated by the Royal Air Force. One wonders why. Because they promised more for civilian use than, shall we say, anti-civilian purposes. They moored them to a special mast at Cardington when the wind was right. Rather like tying up a pet dog that's too big to bring into the sitting room. But though the bigger they come, the harder they fall, some people said, yet aviation was something that many were starting to think big about. In heavier-than-air machines, designers were having a field day trying to dream up the airliner of the future. Very few of them ever got past the prototype stage, but that never seemed to deter anybody from coming out with something even bigger and better. A few more wheels, a few more engines. The German Dornier DoX flying boat. 12 engines on that monster, 6 pulling and 6 pushing. Made a few memorable flights even to America. Then, like all these models, it just seemed to disappear off the market. You couldn't get one anywhere. Looking back, one wonders, who paid for these things? Yet, though hardly noticed, the business of building up the bread-and-butter airlines was going steadily forward. Out went the mails to Croydon, which was London's airport then, and from there to the Middle East, India, and Australia. Caravan trails were there. The bus routes would follow. And flying for the man in the street was well on its way, they said. The more well-to-do, like Ursula Jeans, already owned machines. But why not a plane in every garage? Why not every man's own aerial runabout? Something small, simple, and cheap. That's what people were looking for. Whenever there's a need, there's always somebody trying to fill it. Trying was the word. After all, they used to laugh at Leonardo da Vinci. The only difference between Leonardo and this character was a few centuries. One can't help having a distinct impression that as far as this model was concerned, there was something aerodynamically wrong. Just an impression, but in every field of human endeavor, hope springs eternal. I wonder if he's still drying. And America. How was America behind that Washington parade of 1929? Well, you know the States. Bigger, better, and noisier. Yet always moving forward with a vigor and originality which never fails to surprise the world. The America of Al Smith, Al Jolson, and Al Capone. Babe Ruth and Jack Dempsey, all talking, all singing, all dancing. Yes, things were promising to be even noisier than ever. Election time had come and gone. The people had voted Coolidge out and Herbert Hoover in. Good presidents were always in demand, which was more than could be said for some others. Depression was touching bottom. Apple sellers, the bread line, and plain doing nothing. But it wasn't only the jobless who suffered. In 1929, overnight, the bottom fell out of Wall Street and millions held their breath as their savings melted away like ice under the summer sun. Renewal of sales of stock was the term used. But it meant that in Wall Street there was no such thing as a dead cert any longer. It was a time of despair, suicide, and panic. Bad news travels fast, and the phones were busy. So busy that, yes, believe it or not, telephone operators on roller skates. And then, that's America for you. Original, even in the face of adversity. You see, they had automation worries even then. Wonder what they did for exercise in their spare time. In the States, prohibition didn't make the Depression any easier. Well, prohibition meant that the Depression couldn't drive you to drink. In theory, anyway. It wasn't just a question of sneaking past the customs with the odd bottle, but getting through with a whole shipload. From the 5-mile limit in, you were on your own. But there you are. Where there's a demand, there always has to be a supply. The Coast Guard held different views, however, and expressed them with force. And if you didn't want to be caught with the stuff on you, over the side it had to go. That's rum being watered. When they were caught, those engaged in this trade used to claim in defense that they were only carrying out a public service. I suppose you could call it that at a stretch. Anyway, a stretch is what they got. One must say that as a public service, they couldn't have been better equipped. Radios to keep contact between shipper and wholesaler, cars, trucks, even aeroplanes. And everything they could possibly need for, well, general salesmanship. Yes, it always comes down to the old rules of supply and demand. If people wanted drink, they got drink, and then they drank. That's democracy or something.